This is Lisa from Mobile Tech Review, and this time it's the Lenovo ThinkPad X380 Yoga. A lot of names there in this one. This is basically the spiritual successor to the original Lenovo ThinkPad Yoga 14 from several years ago, and they keep evolving it, and this one's part of the X series line, which means it's relatively thin and light, fairly premium, starts around $1,200. You can get this with an Intel Core i5 or i7, Intel 8th generation CPU, and of course there's an Ultrabook 15-watt CPU inside of here with Intel UHD 620 graphics, not big enough to have anything much more powerful inside, but it does the yoga thing, 360-degree hinges, and it has the active pen, the Wacom AES pen, including the little pen that lives right in the silo here. Of course, you can get Lenovo's optional bigger pen, too, if you get a hand cramp with this little toothpick. We're going to look at it now. So this is a 13.3-inch business-oriented Ultrabook, though obviously anybody can buy it. You can get it with Intel Core i5 and i7 CPUs, like I said, and it has a full HD 13.3-inch display supporting both pen and touch, and that's Wacom AES technology, which is what Lenovo's been using for a while. The pen itself is the active part. Either it's rechargeable, like the little toothpick pen that comes in the silo, or if you buy their optional ThinkPad Pro pen, then that has a quadruple A battery inside. As we'd like to see for something that's in the $1,000 and up price range in 2018, it does have a Thunderbolt 3 port, full 4-lane PCIe there. And surprisingly, it doesn't use USB-C for charging. Lenovo's been doing that more recently, but this one goes with the older rectangular-style charging connector. So that does leave your Thunderbolt 3/USB-C port available at all times. Of course, you can use USB-C charger. I tested that and that works fine, and you can use Thunderbolt docks that can also charge and all that sort of thing. Ports are decent for a small Ultrabook like this. You have your HDMI, you have USB Type A ports, so you're not going to be living in dongle hell. Of course, an audio jack and a SD card slot. Now, LTE 4G is optional and it's going to vary on what country you're in. And right now, looking at Lenovo's US website, I don't see any models that are actually offering that option. But there is a SIM card carrier slot in here, and there internally is a mount point for a 4G LTE card. So I look at Lenovo's website to figure out if you can get it with that, if you do need that. One thing that this loses versus the old like ThinkPad Yoga 14 is it doesn't have dedicated RAM slots, so you can't upgrade the RAM yourself after the fact. You can get it soldered on board, so order it with the amount that you want. You can get it with 8 or 16 gigs of RAM. It has an M.2 SSD, which we would expect, a nice fast SSD, and ours is a fast Samsung drive. You can see the benchmark results there, very nice to see. And it supports NVMe drives, which is what we have inside. There is no hard drive bay in this model because it's meant to be on the thin and light kind of side of things. It has a fingerprint scanner, a Windows Hello IR camera is optional with this model. And it has the usual Intel 8265 AC Wi-Fi. So all in all, a well-rounded Ultrabook and the usual ThinkPad durability with mil-spec tests for dust, shock, vibration, denting your floor. As you know, that's my story. I've dented our wood floor, and every day I look at that divot in the floor because the ThinkPad did that without breaking. The keyboard on this, to me, feels a little soft. You know, ThinkPad keyboards are among the best, and there's not a lot of force required to actuate the keys. The key travel's pretty good on it. I'm not sure why it feels just a little soft, but still, it's a very nice and pleasant keyboard. And the trackpad is a Microsoft Precision trackpad. It's very good, and of course, you have the NavPoint pointer with dedicated buttons for that, for those of you who still like that little red eraser stick pointer that's embedded in the keyboard. The laptop is actually just as light as the Halo, the X1 Yoga third gen, but the catch here is the X1 Yoga is a 14-inch laptop. This is a 13.3-inch, so that explains that. But still, it's quite light, and it's pretty thin, too. It's just 0.8 millimeters thicker than the X1 Carbon, so it's 18.8 millimeters thick. So it's a pretty slim laptop, very portable, obviously. If you're used to one of the smaller ThinkPads, I think that this size will probably fit you pretty well. Even if you're used to a 12.5-inch, it's a very compact body. The display on this actually measures quite well. It is the one and only option, so that's a good thing, especially for a business-oriented laptop. We have good color gamut out here. You get pretty much close to full sRGB coverage. The contrast is actually better than average on this. Now, the calibration out of the box was not really good. Everything looked kind of yellowy, greeny. If you're used to calibrated displays, you'll notice it. But it does calibrate up to pretty close to perfect, which is nice. So get a colorimeter. They cost about $120 if you really care about this, or otherwise eyeball it using the Windows control panel settings for color calibration. It's pretty good overall. The pen experience on this is Wacom AES. I like that pretty well. I generally like it a little bit more than the N-Trig that's used in HP Spectre X360 products and the Surface line, but this one didn't have super duper great palm rejection, which usually is something that Wacom AES is better at. And the pressure curves were good, but they didn't feel quite as buttery as on the X1 Yoga third generation. It may be an older generation of Wacom AES, which might explain the bit of price difference that we see between this and the more expensive X1 Yoga. Still, all in all, it's good. For note-taking, it's great. You might have some palm rejection, whoopsies, where you get an extra line on the screen, that sort of thing. But other than that, it's certainly very competent and capable, and it's even good enough if you want to do some artwork on it, too. In terms of performance, we had the Core i5-8250U, which is the mid-rangey CPU. You can get it with the Core i7 if you want. We have 8 gigs of RAM in our model, and the benchmarks are right where we would expect them to be, very comparable to other Ultrabooks on the market with the same configuration. Honestly, benchmark comparisons aren't even worthwhile because they're all going to be so close to identical. One thing that I do like is with the 2018 ThinkPad line, we've seen them do a little bit of overvolting, so the clock speeds in the Turbo Boost stay higher longer. Like in PC market, Gade, you can see where the graph for the core speed usually goes like that on Ultrabooks. And on this, it's almost straight across. It really just keeps that turbo boost up. So that's good to see. Fan noise is pretty well controlled. It's an Ultrabook. It has a small fan. It's never going to make that much heat or that much noise, to be honest, but it's within the realm of just, I would say, normal and average. You'll hear it if you really push it hard, but nothing annoying, and certainly it can't fill a room with noise, that little fan. Core temperatures on it are also fine, which usually they are for most Ultrabooks. It has a 51 watt hour battery, and like I said, it ships with the rectangular style connector for charging. You could use USB-C charger if you want it. And Lenovo uses a 65 watt charger. 45 watt is adequate, but 65 watt is so it does quick charging. And in fact, it does charge very quickly, faster than the average laptop, which is handy if you're doing a layover at an airport and you need to just top it up a little bit. Now, Lenovo claims up to 12 hours, and like most PC manufacturers, good luck actually getting that. When we set the brightness at 150 nits and use it for a mix of productivity, some Photoshop editing, a little streaming video thrown in, pretty much 7 to 8 hours, which is decent and respectable, certainly. So, as usual with Lenovo, the confusing thing is with so many overlapping models, which one do you pick? If you're interested in this and you're thinking about this versus the X1 Yoga, the more premium model, this one starts at $1,200. The X1 Yoga starts at $1,500. They're the same weight, but like I said, the 14-inch display on the X1 Yoga means that obviously you're getting a little bit bigger laptop for the same weight. The X1 Yoga is a little bit thinner, 18 millimeters versus 18.8 millimeters. They're both pretty skinny. I don't think you're going to care about that. With the X1 Yoga, you get more display options. You can go for a higher resolution QHD display. You can get an HDR display. So that's something that you can't do with the X380 Yoga. You got the Think Shutter option on the X1 Yoga. And I don't know how many people care that much about it. It's the little sliding shutter over the webcam in case you're feeling paranoid. It does offer higher SSD capacities. If you want to go up higher, the X1 Yoga is the way to go. But honestly, you can upgrade the SSD in these after the fact yourself and put in any capacity that you want. And both of them have soldered on RAM. Like I mentioned, I like the pen experience a little bit better on the X1 Yoga 3rd Gen. It feels like it's the latest generation with better pressure curves and a little bit better palm rejection on it. Ah, but there's something interesting here. Now we have the ThinkPad L line with Yoga. So there's a ThinkPad L380 Yoga versus our X380 Yoga. That one starts at $850, and we're going to review that one too. We have that in-house, and I really like that one for the price. What you're foregoing there, though, is you don't get Thunderbolt 3. It has USB-C, but no Thunderbolt 3, and it tops out at a Core i5. If you wanted to get it with a Core i7, you can't do that. But where the L series actually pulls ahead is it still has RAM slots, two RAM slots. So you can go up to 32 gigs of RAM, whereas you're stuck with 16 maximum on the X380 Yoga. That's kind of nice, and it's cheaper too, right? It is heavier though, 3.44 pounds versus 3.08, which is like 1.4 kilograms versus 1.56. So you're going to feel a little bit more weight, but that's not a huge difference either. To open this up, it's pretty straightforward. You see the Phillips head screws, you unscrew them. These are captive screws, which means they stay in the cover so you don't accidentally lose them. So if they don't come all the way out, don't worry. That's the way it should be. Ventilation here, obviously. Take it off, and yeah, I ripped this a little bit, but this is the M.2 SSD slot right here, and ours has a PCIe NVMe SSD. And that's just a little Mylar cover, which I will mangle some more. There we go. There's your SSD slot right there. Memory is soldered on board on this. You can get it with 8 or 16 gigs of RAM, and that's it. And there's our Wi-Fi card, the Intel 8265AC card. this mobile broadband LTE is not actually available in any of the models listed on Lenovo's website, but maybe somewhere it is. My guess is that this is what that would be for. And heatsink, and this is the CPU underneath here. It's pretty small. It's an Ultrabook. It doesn't need that much. And our fan, which obviously shoots hot air directly out the back center and away from you. That's always a good thing. And we have our 51 watt hour battery over here, taking up much of the space inside of the Ultrabook. So that's a Lenovo ThinkPad X380 Yoga. And as I've said before, these days with ThinkPads, you know what you're getting. You're getting something that's really durable. It's pretty well made. It's a nice product. It's going to cost you something, but that none of that's a surprise anymore, is it? And what is a little bit more confusing is the fact that there are so many different lines with a lot of overlap. So hopefully now you understand your options. There is the L380 Yoga if you want something a little bit more affordable and you're willing to give up on a few things. And then there's the X1 third gen, which is still the Halo brand, the thinnest, the bigger screen, the HDR display options if you want those higher end sort of things. I'm Lisa from Mobile Tech Review. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel for more cool tech videos, and thumbs up if you like this vid.